Well, good morning and welcome to Envoy, where we are a people following Jesus to those not yet. Hey, my name is Sean. I'm one of the pastors here. We've been in a series entitled, This is the Way. And it's a bit of a play on the Star Wars series, The Mandalorian, but the main point of this whole series is to talk about the way that Jesus lived his life and the way in which he models that we should live ours. And so the first week we talked about suffering, last week we talked about serving, this week I get to continue this on in our series. But how many of you guys realize that the life of Jesus was not easy? Right? Like if we really take a good look at Jesus' life, it really wasn't easy. And so this morning's topic is going to be no different than the other one. Sorry, but not sorry. But before we get into all of the heavy stuff this morning, I want to ask this simple question. How many of you all have ever had to give up in your life? Ever had to give up? Okay, now let me help you frame this, because some of y'all are like, oh boy, I don't give up. What are you talking about? I'm talking about like you were in an argument and you had to learn how to like surrender that thing and give up in it. I'm talking about some of y'all were driving into church this morning and somebody cut you off and you had to sit there and go, man, like, do I go say hello to them? Or do I let this thing go? Yeah, that's what I'm talking about, okay? See, here's the thing. In our lives, we have to learn when it's time for us to give up, to surrender. Because when we don't do that, our life can turn into a bit of a mess, much like what these guys went through. Take a look at this.
I'm up here, you morons. Come and get me. You guys give up or you're thirsty for more?
Head down!
Don't worry, Marv, I'll get him for you.
Yes, I just showed Home Alone in church. But it's for a good cause. It's for a good cause, y'all. Listen, I love this movie, but I love this scene so much because you've got these two burglars who are just like ridiculously stupid. Like they don't know what the heck they are doing, okay? And they come up against a superior force in Kevin McAllister, okay? I mean, they realize it too because they're getting trashed. I mean, hair's getting torched. I mean, they're getting tar and feathered. I mean, it's absolutely horrible. And in the moment, in the midst of all this trouble, Kevin McAllister gives them this question. He says, do you give up or are you thirsty for more? And in this moment, all these guys had to realize was that they were losing. And if they had just simply given up in this moment and just surrendered this whole thing, they would have saved themselves a lot of pain, a lot of embarrassment, and probably some jail time. Just saying. So before we get any further this morning, I want to turn this question around to you guys at your tables and people up in the balconies. You just got to gather the people around you. But here's my question for you this morning. Has there ever been a time in your life when you needed to give up? And let me add the caveats. Maybe there was something that you needed to give up. Maybe it was a relationship. Maybe it was a fight, whatever it was. But I want you guys to talk about it around your tables. I'm going to give you 5 minutes to do that. Go ahead and discuss now.
Thank you.
All right, let's bring it back. Let's bring it back. This is kind of fun because for some of y'all, you have had to give up things in your life, right? Like you've had to do that. And for some of you guys, refuse to. But whatever side of this conversation you find yourself on, the fact of the matter is, in our lives, we actually have to learn how to give up and how to surrender. Another way we could phrase that this morning, this is where we're going to this morning, would be this, that we need to learn the art of submission in our life. Submission. And the moment I said that word, that immediately evoked all kinds of thoughts, and I know it did. Submission is not a word we typically use in our everyday vernacular. I know that. But in church, we use it, and it's usually associated with one kind of verse, Ephesians 5:22. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. Now, here's the problem with that verse, is that when it gets used, we sort of neglect the verse that comes before it that says, submit both of you to one another out of reverence to Christ. Or we forget the verses that follow that particular verse, and it goes something like this: husbands, love your wives like the Lord loves the church. Meaning that husbands are supposed to lead the way of submission, not wives. We're actually supposed to be the one doing it. Here's the issue with the word submission for us. We have gotten it wrong more times than we've gotten it right. We have. I know, I get it. Because a lot of times that word gets used in very oppressive ways. And I want to dispel that this morning. I want to help us to recontextualize, to redefine it, to reframe this word, because this word is so absolutely important for the Christian life. So let's do this. Let's take a look at this word. So submission, the definition of this word is this: the action or fact of accepting or yielding to a superior force or to the will or authority of another person. In other words, this is what it means. Submission means that I'm accepting that I am not the ultimate authority in my life. That means that I have to sit there and realize I am not the ultimate authority. Another thing we have to understand about submission is this, is that it's something that I'm considering. It is not an authoritative stance. In other words, I cannot make somebody submit to me. I can't. That's not how that works. It's a choice. It's a choice that I personally am making in my own life. It's a heart position that I take. So I can't make somebody do it. I can't take an authoritative stance with it, but it's something I'm considering. And the fact of the matter is that when we look at the life of Jesus, Jesus models for us a life of submission. There's a few ways in which he did it in his life. First of all, he submitted to the Father. He submitted to the Father. Now, before we get too far into this particular subject matter, let me just ask this. Is Jesus equal to the Father? Yes, that's not a trick question. Yes, he is. Our God, who is one, chooses to exist in three distinct persons: the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They are all equal to one another. They all have equal power. They all deserve the equal amounts of reverence. We have to understand that. But they choose to live in perfect harmony with one another. And yet, in the midst of having equal power, Jesus chooses to submit to the Father. Catch this in John 5. He says it like this. Jesus gave him this answer: "Very truly, I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can only do what he sees his Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son also does." What a concept. Jesus understands he can do nothing without the Father. Same with us. We can do nothing without God. So Jesus understands that, but he takes it a step further. In John 6, he says, "For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. Now, I don't know if you understand how crazy this is, okay? Jesus had all power. I mean, all power. He was fully God and he was fully man. He had full power, okay? He was the very definition of meekness, all right? Power under restraint. And yet he chooses in his life to submit to the will of the one who sent him. Now, some of y'all are probably sitting there going like, okay, well, Sean, of course he did. I mean, he's Jesus. Like, that was easy for him. I don't know about all that. Check out what it says in Luke 22. This is Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. It's probably the most human that we ever see Jesus be. It says, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him, and being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. What is he doing here? Because Jesus understands fully what is about to take place. He understands the suffering and the pain that he's about to go through. And yet in the midst of his suffering, what is his prayer? "Not my will, but your will be done." What is he doing? He's submitting himself to the will of the Father. He's submitting himself, even in the midst of his suffering, in the midst of the pain that he knows he's about to go through, he says, "Listen, it's not about my thing, it's about your thing, God. I'll do what you say." That's why when I read that and I read like things like Philippians 2, when we talk about that he humbled himself to the cross, it reframes it for me. That's why I can sit there and look at it and go, wait a minute. Jesus was in the midst of suffering and he struggled with this decision, and yet he still did it, not just out of humility, but out of reverence and submission to the Father. So he submitted to the Father in his life. But the other way he submitted it was through the scripture. He submitted to scripture. Now this is a huge deal because Jesus is the Word. We know that. In John 1, we hear that the Word was in the beginning. We understand that Jesus is the Word. But the truth is that he chooses to submit to it and to the authority of the Word. Do you guys realize that in Jesus' life, the way that he was born, the way he lived his life, when he died, when he resurrected, when he ascended, that in the midst of all of that, he fulfills over 300 prophecies about himself? I mean, that's not an accident. There's no accident in that at all. He purposefully fulfills that. Because why? He submits himself to the scripture. I mean, think about the story about when he comes into Jerusalem riding on a donkey. Let's pick up that story for a second here. This is Matthew 21. It says this. It says, "As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples saying to them, 'Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away.' This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet, 'Say to daughter Zion, see your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" Now, please understand this. Jesus could have come into Jerusalem any way he wanted. He could have picked the finest horse and rode in to Jerusalem. He could have taken the nicest plane and flew in. He could have floated in. Okay, he could have come in like James Bond with an Aston Martin and drove right in to Jerusalem, right? He could have done any of that. But Jesus chooses to come in on a donkey. That's wild. Why in the world would a king come in on a donkey? Because he understood what it meant to submit himself to the scripture. He does it to fulfill what the prophet had already spoken about him. So Jesus submits himself to scripture, but finally, the other place that he submits to is he submits to people. This is not one we typically think about, but he does. Now, there's a caveat to this, that he only submitted to the people that the Father told him to. And he didn't get along with everybody, right? Because we understand that there was this constant battle between him and the Pharisees. We understand that. But there were select people in which he did submit himself. I mean, think about this. He submitted himself to governmental authority. Like, he paid taxes, people. Like, he paid taxes. I mean, he submitted himself to Pilate in that sham of a trial that he was put on. He even submitted himself to Pilate's judgment when he ends up going to the cross. Jesus even goes so far to submit himself to baptism from John, his cousin. And John's not even all that thrilled about it. Let's pick up that story for a second. This is Matthew 3. It says, then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to deter him, saying, I need to be baptized by you. And do you come to me? Jesus replied, let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this to fulfill all righteousness. Then John consented, and as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was open. He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen, y'all. Jesus models for us a life of complete submission. And it wasn't because it was always easy, but here's the truth. It is the way. This is the way of the cross. It's submission. So my question for us this morning is, why is it so hard for us to do it? Like, why is it so hard? I mean, we understand from an intellectual understanding that like Jesus did it in his life. We understand he submitted to the Father. He submitted to Scripture. He even submitted to people. We get that. But why is it so hard for us to practically do it? And I think there's a few things that are hindrances, that are sort of walls that we got to get past in order for us to get to a place of submission in our life. The first one is this. We need to deal with control. Control. Now, we all like to be in control in our lives. Like, let's not kid ourselves. Let's not pretend like we don't do it. We all love to be in control. I mean, we love to make plans, plan out all the details. I mean, heck, we love to sit there and be able to sit and like plan out the ending of our story so that we know exactly what's going to happen. But the longer you live this life, you realize that control is merely a facade, because a lot of the things that you think you have control over, you really don't. Right? That's our problem with submission, because see, submission tells us that we have to submit our control to the one who actually has true control, but we don't like doing that because we like to be able to have full power and authority over everything we do in our life. Am I talking to anybody out here? You know what I'm talking about, right? Like, this is hard for us, okay? But catch what Proverbs 16 says. It says, in their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps. Yikes. Right? Like, I've been there, right? You make all the plans, you make all the details. But the truth of the matter is that it's not me who gets to determine my course in my life. It's actually God. See, the problem with control gets resolved when I learn how to trust. Control gets resolved when I learn to trust in my life. And I'm not talking about blind trust. I'm talking about trusting the one who created you. I'm talking about trusting the one who went before you, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I'm talking about trusting your God, who knows every detail of your life and only has the best for you. But we have to learn how to be able to trust him with the control in our life. We have to be willing to submit control of our life to him. Some of you all are in this place this morning, and you're going, hey, I've got this big decision I got to make. But the mistake that we make as human beings is this, is that we make all the plans in the world, and we say, God, bless my plans. Don't do that. Don't do that. Instead, what we should be doing is saying, God, not my will, but your will be done. What do you want to do with me? Every single day, getting up and going, Lord, what's your plan for my day? How do you want to do it? It's submitting control over every aspect of my life and saying, hey, here you go. Listen, if you have anxiety and stress in your life, I can guarantee you, you probably have a control issue. Guarantee you, you have got a control problem. Okay? And the only way you're going to get rid of that anxiety and that stress, which is not from God, by the way, that's not from God. That's a world thing. The only way I'm going to get rid of that is if I'm willing to submit control to my all-knowing God. So control is one of the walls that we deal with. The next one, this is kind of the hidden one for us, would be pride. Pride. This is a tough one because we don't always see pride pop up in our life. But pride presents itself whenever I think that my way, that my life, my priorities are more important than to everyone else around me. And pride is in direct contrast to submission. And that seems really counterintuitive in our culture, because our culture is very much about you doing you, right? You probably have all heard the phrase, you do you, boo-boo, right? You probably heard it. You do you, boo-boo. What does that mean? That really just means, hey, you do your thing, you accomplish your stuff, you make you the priority, it's all about you. But there's a problem with that mentality, because that goes in direct contrast to the way of the kingdom. Catch this. We've been reading this verse throughout the series. It says, for the way of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Listen to me. When we look at the life of Jesus, his life is ridiculous. It's absurd. The way that he suffers, the way that he serves, the way that he submits. But the fact of the matter is, this is the way. This is the way. And so the problem with pride is that when pride creeps into my life, it is in direct contrast to the way of the kingdom. Because Jesus actually has a different way to talk about this thing. He says it like this. He says, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. Listen, y'all, we got to be able to get out of the way. Because the fact of the matter is that we are not the most important person in our story. Let me say that again. You and I are not the most important person in our stories. We're not. We have to be willing to get rid of this pride thing because it creeps up in everything that we do. For all my married people in the room, I'm gonna give you some really good advice. Ever been in an argument with your spouse? Or am I the only heathen in the room? Ever been in an argument with your spouse? And nothing seems to be getting resolved. And you just keep going back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And it just like, it's so frustrating. We're like, why won't you just listen to me? And the whole time you're going back and forth. And what's happening is this. Puffing up and puffing up and puffing up. And you know the best way to resolve an argument is when somebody is willing to sit there and go low and just say, I'm sorry. Guarantee you that argument completely falls apart. Because see, the thing that resolves pride in our life is humility. It's being willing to go low, even if you're right. Even if you're right, it's being willing to go low and choose to exalt the other person. That's how we get rid of pride. And in our lives with Jesus, the truth is that if we want to resolve this idea with him, we just need to be willing to sit there and say, Lord, I'm not the most important person. You are. Let me go low so that you can be made known. So pride. But the last thing I think that we don't think about often would be this. Fear. Fear. That's the, I think, one of the other walls we deal with submission here. Now, I'm not talking about being terrified. That's not what I'm getting at here. I'm talking about the hidden fears. Okay, I'm talking about what the fear of what will submission cost me. There's this thought that when we submit in our life that we will lose our voice. Or there's this thought that if we submit that it will mean that our needs will not be met. Or there's this thought that our submission will lead us to being taken advantage of. Right? And for my people in the room who have been hurt, that's why this is so hard for you. There's this fear that creeps into us that goes, man, I don't know if I can actually do this because I'm just afraid that it's not going to be reciprocated. Now, I will say this. There's the difference between legitimate fears, history has taught you some things, versus contrived fears, things that you're just kind of making up some things going on in your heart. But no matter which side of the fence you happen to be on, let me just say this to you. It doesn't forego what God has told us to do. Whether it's these real fears or contrived fears, no matter what, it doesn't forego what God has instructed us to do in our life. Because see, when we submit, it actually displays the Father's heart. So how do I deal with fear? The fear of submission, submission can only come from a place of love. Here's what I mean. Let's go back to that marriage example for a second, okay? I can't submit to my wife out of a place of obligation. That will only take me so far. It's got to come out of a place of love for my wife. The place of submission, you know, think about it for parents. I'm a new parent, but one of the things I've learned is this, is that I don't always have the right answer. I just don't. And sometimes as parents, one of the things you can do is you can learn how to submit to your kids. And how do you do that? You just simply say, hey, I'm not perfect, I'm sorry. Kids, students, hey, listen, all that butting of heads you keep doing with your parents, it's not getting you anywhere, right? Here's how you deal with it. You choose to go low and say, yeah, whatever you're asking me to do, yeah, absolutely, I can get that. I got you covered. That's what it looks like for us. And the way that in which we submit in our earthly relationships is the same way in which we submit in our heavenly relationships. Here's what I mean by that. Submission doesn't come from a place of obligation. It's the overflow of an intimate relationship with Jesus, which then empowers me to submit my life to him. Like I said, I can't just simply submit my life to Jesus because I'm obligated. It cannot come out of this place of, well, you know, Jesus said so. That will only take you so far. And it will give you a very surface level relationship with him. But when we're willing to get real close with him, and we're willing to sit there and we're willing to submit everything in our life to him, and we're willing to let go of our fear and our pride and our control, then what happens is this, is that it becomes this overflow of my heart. It's no longer this thing that I'm just told I have to do. It becomes this choice that I would love to do and I'm willing to do because I understand the one I'm submitting to. So this morning, as I get ready to wrap this thing up and the band comes back on stage, listen, y'all, submission is not an ugly word. It's not. it's been turned into that in our culture, but it's really not this ugly word. It's this beautiful, beautiful idea. It's this beautiful thing that when we get it right, it does something incredible. When we get it right, it looks a whole lot like the Trinity and what's constantly happening within the Trinity. What do I mean? The Father is constantly submitting himself to the Son. And the Son is constantly submitting himself back to the Father. And then the Son, Jesus, he's constantly submitting himself to the Holy Spirit. I mean, he can't help himself but to do it. He can't help. And they constantly are submitting to one another over and over and over and going low and exalting and going low and exalting. And as they do it, there's this beautiful harmony that takes place. Look, when we get submission right in our marriage, it looks like harmony. It looks like less arguments. Because why? Because now my pride is not getting in the way. My issue with control isn't getting in the way. I'm actually willing to sit there and go, hey, let me submit to you. Let me make you more important than me. And what happens is this, when we start to do that, then the other person goes, hey, wait a minute, let me do the same thing for you. Let me go low and let me exalt you and let me lift you up. And there's this constant thing that's going on, constant humility, constant lifting up. And it just this beautiful, beautiful example of what marriage is truly supposed to be. When we get it right with our kids, listen, they don't look at us and go, wow, you're the authoritarian. They look at us and they go, whoa, wait a minute, you're human too. And guess what happens when we're willing to submit as parents? Then our kids go, wait a minute, I'm okay with that. Why don't I do the same thing? Let me go low and let me submit to what you're asking me to do. When we submit our finances to God, all of a sudden, all the anxiety and the stress that we've been feeling, the weight of all this stuff, it just starts to go away. Why? Because I'm submitting control over to the one who really has the control, who has my best interests at heart. But it all has to start with a choice. It all starts with a choice. Am I willing to not be the main character of my story? Am I willing to give up my control? Am I willing to let go of my fear? Am I willing to submit myself fully to my God that I know that truly loves me? See, we see that in Jesus' story, as we get ready to celebrate Easter, we see that in his story, that Jesus loves us so much that he submits himself to the cross and to death and dying a death that we truly deserve. That's what happens. So this morning, we're going to take communion together before we go back into worship. You've got communion cups around your tables. But this morning, I want us to just begin to think about the way that Jesus modeled it for us. See, Jesus doesn't just ask us to do things that he wasn't willing to do himself. He shows us. He shows us the way. And he showed us the way by going to that cross, dying the death that we really deserved. So this morning, let's take the bread in remembrance of his body broken for us. And let's take the cup, remembering his blood that was spilled out for us. So Lord Jesus, right now, we come before you. We thank you, God. We thank you, God, that you model for us what it looks like to submit. It's a word that we've messed up on. We've done it the wrong way so many times. And Lord, for that, we ask for forgiveness. But right now, Lord, we ask that you would help us to do it. To submit in every aspect of our life. To submit in every detail of our life. Every plan that we may have. Every worry, anxiety that we may have. Every bit of control. Every fear. Any pride that's within us, Lord. Right now, we submit it all to you. So, Lord, right now, we ask that you would help us to make that change, to make that correction, so we can look more like you. We love you, Jesus. Amen. This morning, as we get ready to go back into worship, I just want to let you know that we're going to have our pastors and our elders down front, but I want to make a very specific call for prayer this morning. If you're in this place and you would sit there and say, Sean, I have been struggling with submission in my life, and maybe it's an issue of control. Maybe for you, it's pride. Maybe it's this fear that you may have. Whatever it may be, I want to make that call for you. If that's you in this place, I want you to come down front. We want to pray with you. Because the fact of the matter is, you do not have to stay in that place any longer. You don't. Because the way of the cross, the way in which we're supposed to live our life, is truly one of submission. If you're in this place this morning and you would say, hey, you're talking about submission, but you've never made the first step of submission, which is to baptism. Today is that day for you. I want you to come down front. We want to pray with you. We want to help you to be able to take that next step. Because let me tell you all right now that first step of submission to baptism, there's nothing like it, and it will change your life truly forever. So why don't we do this? Let's stand up and let's give God some glory.